Hello and welcome to Gold and Silver Assets. I'm Diora and it's Sunday the 17th of April 2022. The big crash strategy. Well, look, I think one thing we can all agree on is that it's coming. There's going to be a big crash coming at some point. The question is, if you know it's coming, and even better if you can time when it's going to come, what are you going to do about it? How are you going to manage your portfolio? So the first thing we want to know is, first of all, when is it going to peak? When is the stock market going to peak before the big, big crash? What price is that going to happen at? Even bigger question is when? That's actually a lot harder to answer, but we'll give it a go over here. And of course, if we have a rough idea at least of those two things, what are you going to do with your portfolio? And now with the strategies that I'm going to talk about, I'm working on the assumption that, you know, you're like me, you're a retail investor, and that you don't short the market. And also we're kind of working on long only strategies, so even things like put options are not being used. Now, of course, some of you will be able to do that. I'm just telling you that I don't have those skills. And so that's the assumption that I'm working on here. Okay. And of course, before we go any further, I've got a disclaimer. The first thing is, I don't know. I don't know what's going to happen and when it's going to happen. There are a lot of assumptions based on what I'm going to present. And as I said, I'm absolutely useless when it comes to timing these things, okay? So take what I say with a pinch of salt. This is really just a thought experiment. Get you thinking about how you're going to do things, really. Right, so let's start with this chart. This looks a bit of a mess, doesn't it, relative to my usual charts. But we'll go through it bit by bit. Right, so first of all, in orange here, this orange line is the US 10-year minus the 2-year. And the reason I've put this here is that this shows us when inversions happen. And so that's the zero line, which is red over here. So anytime we go below that line, that's an inversion. And I've actually marked the inversions by these vertical green lines. The bars over here, that's the S&P 500. And so what I've done here, I've written all these numbers here. What that is the number of months between when this inversion occurs, so the first time this crosses here, and when the stock market drops, you know, reasonably significantly. Now, so back in 1988, it took 18 months. Over here, I haven't got the date, it's covered up here, but that one was 2 months there. This one over here in 2000 took 7 months. And then over here, so I'm looking at this first crossing, that was 5 months. And then we very quickly had another cross over here at 16 months. That was in 2006. So that was quite a long, much longer time between the inversion and this drop over here. And then, of course, the most recent one was in August 2019. And 6 months later, we had a massive drop over here as well. And of course, we recently just inverted a couple of weeks ago. So I've done this just to give you an idea of the kind of timescales in which you can expect a drop in the stock market. Now, obviously, it's quite a long range. We're looking at 2 months to 16 months. But, you know, it's most common is around the 6 month kind of area. That seems to be the most common. So, yeah, I would probably say anywhere between 6 months to a year, let's say. So we've got to beware. But I guess the good news is it's not imminent. It's not going to be next week. according to this, if this is correct. Right, so this is the S&P 500 on the log scale, and this goes back all the way back to 1929 here. This is that big 1929 drop over here. And what I've done, so I've joined the bottom over here to these lows over here and here, and you can see I've basically made it into a channel. So the upper blue line is a channel, and what I've done is lock it onto this high here. Now notice it doesn't actually touch anywhere else, so we have no idea how reliable the top of that channel is. The other possibility is I've joined the very peak from 1929 to this peak here, and so we get this orange line here. So this kind of gives you an idea of the kind of trading range, I guess, and those are at the extremes there. Now we've got this midline of this channel here, which is quite interesting because you can see here it bounced off of it numerous times, and that then became resistance over here. And similarly here, it was resistance and then it broke through and found support back on it again. So, and again over here, a little bit of resistance here before breaking through. So that's also a very interesting line to keep in mind. So to me, that tells me that, look, if we're not going to drop significantly, then, you know, we're either going to go sideways until that happens, but more likely upwards, actually, I think. And so the question is, what's our kind of upside targets over here? So this is zoomed in. That's that same chart. And if we look over here, now, just to remind you all that I did make a video called, I think it's called This Happens Before the Crash. And so that tells you why I'm thinking more upside. There's some kind of psychological elements that we need to consider as well. That's why I think we've got a pretty decent melt up coming. And so what we need to do, though, is because it's probably going to get quite enthusiastic, shall we say, and we've got to keep our heads. So this is kind of thinking ahead and thinking of possibilities. So in terms of the upper range of where this could go, it will depend, of course, on how long it takes to peak. But I'm thinking the peak will happen somewhere in this range, okay? And look, I'm going to go out on a limb here and tell you what my target level is. So we're kind of looking over here. You might say, well, what's that then? I'm thinking around the kind of 6,600-ish, which would kind of be quite appropriate, wouldn't it? I guess, you know, because I mean, my view is that I think we're looking at a crime scene here. This is Exhibit A. And this is a financial crime in progress, I guess you could say. Yeah, I guess, you know, week after week, we've been looking at all these footprints of crime, I guess. Oh, dear. Oh, dear. I guess we could change the channel's name to CSI Finance, eh? Anyway, look, I'm just speculating here, but it wouldn't surprise me, shall we say. Right. Anyway, I think that's not impossible at this stage, but I think the peak will happen within this range. And so I think once we get to the 6,000, then that's when I'd start getting a bit nervous and be wary. And then, of course, in terms of how far down it will crash, I think there's a couple of options. One is this trend line here. And then, of course, there's this one here. Now, I'm not sure that they'll allow it to go that far, because I think there's going to be mega printing. If you thought they printed a lot here, probably you ain't seen nothing yet. So, yeah, so the bottom could be here. But remember, I mean, that's, we're looking at 50% drop there. It could go partially into this lower part of the channel as well. So, I mean, I guess you've got a fair amount of support over here. So yeah, maybe around 3,000. But yeah, that's a big drop. And so you've got to brace yourself for that, right? But also, make the most of any upside that there is. Right. And gold, where's that going to peak then, if that's the case? I'll update my trajectory video. I did a trajectory video last year, and I think it's worth updating, obviously, because we've got new data since then. But one thing I thought we could look at for gold, not so much the peak, but the cycle lows, because that seems to be much more reliable for gold. Now, a little while back, I talked about how people are talking about the 8-year cycle low pattern. And what I'd done is use the tool on TradingView and did those kind of cycle things there. And it just only seemed to work for a couple of cycles. And then back here, it wasn't very accurate at all. But then I thought, look, there's something not quite right there. And so what I've done here is actually draw the lows in with these vertical lines and then calculate the number of months between them. Now, if you just eyeball it actually looks pretty regular, but obviously there are some differences here. And it's these differences that cause problems when you use that cycle tool. So with the cycle tool, you see, if you're 1 month out between cycles, then that error will compound. And then, of course, you're going to get new errors the next month as well. And so that's why it's probably not so useful, I think, anyway. And this is probably a much better way of doing it. It's just a bit of a pain because you have to do it manually. But if you look at these numbers, I mean, they're kind of, let's say, 90 to 95 bars, aren't they, on average? Obviously, we've got a particularly long one here. But look, let's say 90 bars, okay, give or take, let's say 6 months. So what I've done here, the last cycle low was in 2015, and so this tells me that the next cycle low can be expected, let's say 90 bars, that'll be June 2023. But of course, remember, it could be a few months later than that. So basically the second half of 2023 is when you want to start looking at the lows for gold. So obviously the peak will be before then, and of course we don't know how long it's going to take to get to those lows. I'm estimating 6 to 9 months, let's say, maybe. So, which means that later this year, we can expect a peak in gold. And so what I'm thinking here is something like this, and then come back down before resuming the uptrend. Okay, but I'll talk about that in a moment. Okay, and then the next asset I want to talk about is Bitcoin. And so here, what I've done in the bars, we've got Bitcoin, and then in orange, we've got the S&P 500. And the reason I've shown this is that, obviously, whenever the S&P 500 over here drops significantly, and over here you can see, there are quite substantial drops in this asset class as well, particularly over here. And so, obviously, if we're looking for a big crash to occur in the stock market at some point, then I think it's fair to say we can expect a decent drop in Bitcoin as well, but obviously not just yet. This, I think, will drop from a higher level. Right, so having said all that, so we've talked about a little bit about what kind of price levels for the stock market, and we've talked about rough timings. So let's say you've been very good, you've taken your profits at the very top there. What do you do next? Okay, obviously, work on the assumption that you're going to be long. Okay, so if that's the case, what's the best assets to be in as the crash kind of proceeds? Now, you might say, oh, but surely you should be short. And yeah, I mean, ideally, if you know how to do that, and even things like put options, then great. The problem I have with put options is that I'm rubbish at timing again. And with a crash, you know, you get rip-roaring rallies as well, which can take you out of your put positions as well. So it's not an easy one. It's not an easy one. If anyone knows a very straightforward way of playing on the downside of a massive crash, yeah, let us know. Okay, so let's start looking at what asset prices did during the various crashes that have occurred in the past. So I've gone back to the year 2000, and at that time, I think it was about a two-year period, the S&P 500 dropped 49%. The TLT, that's a bond ETF. Now, that wasn't around then, so that's not applicable there. However, the 10-year yield did drop 38%, which basically tells us bond prices went up. So bonds were pretty good at that time. The DXY was up 20%. So what that tells us is relative to the other currencies, the US dollar did well. So a tick there. Of course, Bitcoin didn't even exist then, so we can't include that. Gold was actually flat over that time. And so again, that's a good thing. It didn't lose like the stock market did. The GDX didn't exist then either. But silver dropped 32%. So that's not so good, is it? And of course, the SILJ didn't exist then. Let's move forward in time. So in 2008, the S&P 500 dropped 57%. So that's a substantial drop there. The bond ETF was up 47%. So that was a good thing to be in. At that time, the bond yield had dropped 60%, the 10-year US 10-year bond. The US dollar index was up 23%. So again, suggests that the US dollar was a good thing to be in compared to other currencies. Again, Bitcoin did not exist at that point. And gold dropped 35%. So it didn't drop as much as the stock market dropped. That's all we can say there. GDX, so the gold miners were absolutely trashed, weren't they? 72% drop. Ouch, painful. Silver was pretty bad as well, 60% drop. And of course, the SILJ, I don't have data for that at that time. So according to this, cash and bonds were good in 2008. But also gold was better than the stock market, and all of them were better than silver and the GDX. Okay, and finally, we've got February 2020, and at that time, the S&P 500 dropped 35%. Now, this TLT ETF, something weird happened there. So I was looking at the chart, and this dropped 25%, but the US 10-year bond yield was down 80%, which means that when the yields go down, the price of the bond goes up. So I'm not quite sure what's going on there. I don't really kind of look at that much, to be honest. So I don't have a deep understanding. So that's just a bit strange. I'm not sure what went on there. Okay, the DXY also was a little bit strange because initially it dropped 5% and then it went up 3%. So basically just volatile over there. Bitcoin dropped 63%, so that did worse than the stocks. And gold actually only dropped 15%, and of course it recovered pretty quickly. GDX dropped 48%, and silver dropped 38%, SILJ 58%. So basically, the miners do pretty badly, you can see, whenever the crash is. So the thing to remember there is when you've got your miners, and you know, when they're doing really well, and you've got, if you start to notice the euphoria, either in yourself or in others, don't be afraid to sell some even, you know. You could, dollar cost averaging doesn't just work on when you're buying, it's also good when you're selling as well, you know, lock in those profits. So conclusions are that cash is the best in a crash scenario, but I think there's something slightly different this time. Now, obviously in 2008 when that happened, you know, for most people, yeah, cash was going to be the best thing. However, not in all countries, of course. You know, say you lived in Cyprus and they had the bank bail-in, that's a very different matter. You know, if you had above a certain amount of cash sitting there, it would have been swiped, basically. And I kind of get the feeling that that was just a test run, and this time they're going to use it on everyone, potentially. You know, I hope I'm wrong. I hope I'm wrong on that. But yeah, I just get that sense. And so, you know, say you've taken all your profits and you've just got cash sitting there. That's great if you want to take advantage of, you know, when price eventually bottoms. But what if a bail-in occurs on the way down? So that's one of the things I've been kind of considering. But yeah, I'll be very, very interested in your thoughts on that. The other thing that we can conclude from this is that gold actually seemed to drop the least. It certainly dropped less than the stock market dropped. And so, you know, if we think that it's just going to be a temporary drop and price is going to go much, much higher, then, you know, maybe it's best just to stay in physical and just sit through that drop rather than sell at that peak, you know. Rather than convert it to cash. Again, I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are on that. And of course, Bitcoin, silver, and the miners drop the most. And so, you know, perhaps, so those are the ones that you want to get out at the top, because you're going to get substantial drops. I mean, we're talking, you know, 60, 70, 80% drops. So that's going to be painful, all right? And I doubt that, you know, that this time's going to be any different. That's just how the miners behave, and silver as well. And so, you know, you've got to think about how we're going to manage that. So, you know, when you do take your profits from these things, what are you going to do with them? Obviously, buying real assets with them that you need, things that you need, things that you can physically use, is probably the number one priority, I'd say. But of course, you know, beyond that, if you've got extra, what's going to be the best thing? I'm kind of starting to wonder whether, you know, even if you buy gold, convert it to gold, yes, okay, it might be at the peak. And if you're expecting, let's say, a 30% drop, at least you've still got that physical there, particularly if you don't intend on selling it after that drop as well. And at least, you know, you've got less of an issue in terms of bail-in risk there. Anyway, those are just some random thoughts of mine. I'd be really interested to hear in the comments section what your thoughts are. How are you going to deal with your profits? What are you going to do with them? Where are you going to put them? And how are you going to manage the big one, the big crash coming? Next up, the market update. We shall start with gold priced in US dollars on the daily scale. And I still think that this is the short-term low over here, and I think we're going up from here. So based on that assumption, what I've done is draw this trend line over here, and that's just by joining this low and this low. And so let's see if that holds, basically. My thoughts are that we are in an uptrend, and we will remain in an uptrend until proven otherwise. And what do I mean by until proven otherwise? Well, there's two, it does depend on the time scale you're looking at. So if you're looking at a very short time scale, then proven otherwise means coming below this line, which is, let's say, about 1930. And if you're looking at a longer timescale for your uptrend, then of course 1800, I would say, would be your line in the sand there. I don't think either of those are going to be breached. So what's going on here? Well, we moved up here. Price, you can see here, dropped down to hit this kind of support here and went back up again, which is a good sign. So from here, I think we're probably going to go up a bit more. What's the worst case? I think back to 1960, really. I'm doubtful we're going to go much below that. So basically, I'm just looking up. I'm just looking up from here. And silver, similar kind of story, really. This is that bigger trend line that I drew from a previous video. You'll see that if you zoom out. But yeah, at the moment, you know, we had a strong move up here. This kind of corrected downwards. We got a very strong rejection at 24. So I don't think we're going to see 24 again. If we do move down from here, 25 looks like pretty good support, actually. Because you've got all of this over here as well. So, yeah, I think the maximum downside here is 25. We do have some resistance above that around this 26 level. So really, we need to start seeing 26 as being support. So ideally, we want to see something like this before going further up. You could, again, do a similar trend line to what I did with the gold. So you could draw something like this as well. But yeah, I'm bullish looking upwards here for this. Let's have a look at the gold silver ratio. So again, this is on the daily scale. And previously, you remember that I drew this upsloping channel. And if you look here, you can see that this ratio seems to be squeezing. And so usually when that happens, it's very common to get a big move. Which direction is that move going to happen? Well, of course, I think it's going to be downwards. I think we're not too far off, because with these things, it usually you get the breakout about 70-75% along the length of this, and we're getting in that area there, aren't we? So I'm thinking probably something like this, and sometimes you can get a retest. It might go all the way up there, even. It could go as high as that and then come through there. And it's when it breaches this channel that's going to be the big move in silver. But yeah, this is looking good. GDX, again on the daily scale, and as I said before, this is a trending price action here, and as long as we're in an uptrend, we have to assume we will remain in an uptrend. We'd drawn it like this, and price seems to have broken out. Now, sometimes you can get a retest of this, but if we've got this trend line here, what might happen is, worst case scenario, come down a little bit here before resuming up. But I'm actually thinking this is going to go up first before getting to that trend line again. So yeah, it looks like we've got this flag on a pole, seems to be playing out like that at the moment. So higher targets ahead. The other thing is, you know, we've got some gaps above that need to be filled as well. There's a little one over here, certainly. And here we've got the SILJ, so similar story. This looks like the pole, and this one took a little bit longer to break out. So it was in the last two trading days that occurred. So we got a nice strong move above there. Retested that a bit and moved back up again. So I still think we're going to move up first. And it may be that we kind of go up like this a little bit and then come back down towards that trend line and then the big, big move up like that. Good. So that's it from me. I hope you're enjoying a nice break at the moment. This was a slightly longer bumper Easter edition for you all. I hope you enjoyed it. We've been enjoying a nice break over here. In fact, interestingly, yesterday we were at the beach, and I've never seen this before, but here we get quite a lot of black swans, like I mean the actual animal here. And normally you see them on lakes or rivers, but yesterday we were at the beach and we saw about six black swans in the water, in the ocean, which was very unusual. I've never seen that before. Anyway, I thought that was quite interesting. Right, that's it from me. See you all next week. Bye.